Hello, I'm Monsignor Jim Lisante. Today on Personally Speaking, I'll be joined by Pulitzer Prize winning reporter and author Timothy Egan, whose latest book is called A Pilgrimage to Eternity. Please stay with us. Welcome to Personally Speaking. I'm your host, Monsignor Jim Lisante, and New York Times best-selling author and reporter Timothy Egan joins me now. Timothy is a Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter and the author of 9 books. His most recent one is called A Pilgrimage to Eternity, subtitled From Canterbury to Rome in Search of a Faith. The book is Timothy's account of his pilgrimage throughout the French and Italian countryside along the Via Francigena, exploring the rich history of Christianity as he attempts to decide what he believes. Timothy chose to walk most of the 1,200 miles route, but also allowed himself 2 wheels, 4 wheels, train, or any other method that kept him on the ground. Timothy writes a weekly column for the New York Times, and he's here with us today to tell us about his pilgrimage, which is a comprehensive history of Christianity in Western Europe and how it changed his life. Joining me now, I'm very pleased to welcome to Personally Speaking, the author, Timothy Egan. We're talking to Timothy Egan. I have been a regular reader of his column in the New York Times for many years, so I was intrigued by A Pilgrimage to Eternity, and I thank you, Tim, for coming on our show. Thank you so much.
It's wonderful to be with you. Thanks for hosting me.
Let me ask you, you write in the book, as you write in your column, what I call so often about the great divide, you know, whether it's political or religious, the things that divide people. So here's what I'm wondering, when you're writing, whether it's the book or the column, Tim, do you have an ability to listen to both sides? You might be called progressive, but are there people in your life who are clearly on the right side of things, but you're going to listen to them with an open mind and an open heart? Do you find that you have that?
Yeah, you know, I come from an Irish Catholic family of 9, and I think probably, I know we have at least 2 Trump supporters in the family. So, I mean, just even before COVID, we had some pretty vigorous family discussions, you know, when you could meet and get together. And, you know, and the town where I grew up in Spokane, Washington, is a red city and fairly conservative. And I don't want to ever just preach to the choir. I don't want to ever, you know, whatever voice I have, I want to try to understand the other side. So certainly politically, I try to do that. But I mean, sometimes my anger gets the best of me, you know, in writing about these. Sometimes my, you know, why can't they see what I'm seeing gets the best of me. But in this book, in Pilgrimage to Eternity, it was something different. I wanted to strip away all my cynicism. And I wanted, I'm a journalist by profession, have been my entire life. I wanted to get rid of my skepticism and really look at all these issues of Catholicism fresh and clean. It's a very hard thing to do. I mean, because you've got a lifetime of, you know, rationality and back and forth and this and that. But the whole point of a pilgrimage is to try to learn something about yourself and the greater issues. And so, you know, politics aside, you know, in the spiritual realm, I really wanted to just be fresh.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you come across very clearly. And what I love too for our listeners is in the book, you get into lots of skeptical issues, certainly, but I love when you have the dialogues with your wife. For our listeners who may not know, while Timothy's raised Catholic, his wife is Jewish, and they have this great dialogue and questions and answers and learning from each other. Tell me, if I, maybe you know this about me, probably don't know about it, but every wedding I do, and I do hundreds every year, I insist that the couple write me an essay, why of all the people they could marry, why is this the one? Because I want to preach with some knowledge of how anybody comes to decide this is the person for life. So when you look back on the years of marriage to Joni, why her?
I mean, that's a really tough question. I didn't expect to get that. we've been married, 35 years. I say this in the book, one of the great things about Catholicism that I realized about my family late in life, you know, my mother was somewhat troubled in her marriage. She's dead, and so is my father. They stayed together through some pretty rough times. There was a point when she was going to leave him, because she felt that he didn't get her and he wasn't, they were different. They drifted apart. And he was a blue collar guy. She loved to read and she was a progressive Catholic and she was an intellectual and she was an artist. And she probably would have only had two kids instead of seven, yeah. You know, in the modern era. But I realized late in my life and her, in her life, she stayed in her marriage in part because of her Catholic upbringing. Mm-hmm. And she came to love her husband, my father, when she saw what a good father he could be.
Yeah.
I went into my marriage. This is one of the things of my Catholicism, even if my faith was questioned, believing it was the one and only, you know, that this is it. Now, a lot of people, most people, I'm sure, think that. No one goes into a marriage thinking,
this is going to get going.
We'll see how it works out. You know, but I went into it, you know, thinking I'm only going to be married once and I'm going to make it work. And I think that was one of the residues of my Catholicism, such as it was, you know, that was a good thing. Now, why Joni? I mean, we complete each other. We have these wonderful discussions, you know, about the afterlife. And she keeps, you know, the Jewish version of the afterlife is a little different than, you know, Christian version, although no one really knows, of course. You know, we joke, you know, is it good bagels? You're sitting around and everybody's sort of, you know, laughing and talking. She says, no, the Jewish version of the afterlife is that, you know, you live on by how you've lived your life. Your legacy is how you lived. And that, you know, that you continue to be a good spirit in that sense, you know. So we had a lot of discussions about that. She joined me for the last 100 miles of the pilgrimage. Now this is 1,100-mile walk from Cantebury to Rome. And my Jewish wife joins me and something, you know, happens to me in the book that's very profound near the end. I don't know if I want to call it a miracle, but something happened that I could not explain. And so we had a lot of back and forth on that. So it was good to have her skepticism with me when that happened.
And would you do it again, Joni?
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Good.
I'm going to be seeing this when we're in the same house. Yeah. Well, I mean, it goes without saying, you know, yes, of course. I'm a happily married man. I'm happy to say that.
I like to hear that. Listen, related to marriage and family life, Paul Newman, who we talked to 100 years ago, one of the things he said was that while his mother was Catholic, his father was Jewish, he was sad that their choice was not to get into the politics of religion by avoiding religion, not raising the child as anything. And he said in the interview, I regret that in that I come from two great traditions and I learned nothing about either. And I would have benefited from knowing both my Jewish and my Catholic heritage. Did you and Joni not make a similar decision?
Yeah, I talk about that in the book, and that's a very great insight on your part. And it's interesting to hear that Paul Newman had the same effect. You know, we come from these two fabulous traditions.
Yeah.
I'm an Irish Catholic. I'm an Irish nationalist. I mean, Catholicism to me is keeping the Brits from trying to strip we Irish Catholics of everything we had, our language, our culture, our faith. You know, even our sports were outlawed. Hurling was outlawed for a while. So to me, it's a real strong identity thing. And I think that's the way a lot of Irish Catholics felt. But we failed. And I say it in the book, you know, both my children joined me at certain parts of the pilgrimage to Rome. Mm-hmm. And I realized along the way, you know, I'm talking about Francis of Assisi, or I'm talking about miracles, or I'm talking about, you know, something that I know, you know, as an article of faith, they don't have no idea what I was talking about. They lacked literacy. And my daughter told me this. She said, she went to Stanford. She has a master's degree in public health from Cal. And she said, you know, Dad, I feel like I have this huge area of my life where I'm just ignorant. And so I say in the book that and it's hard for me to say this, one of our failings as parents, my wife and I, was the failure to give these, we sort of just took a neutral position.
Yeah,
so we just didn't talk about it. You know, my Catholicism, her being Jewish, we just didn't bring it to the table. So our kids were raised without this literacy, this great knowledge of these two great faiths. So I regret that.
And it's in the book. Timothy Egan's our guest. His book is A Pilgrimage to Eternity, and I hope our listeners will get it. Now, one of the things I was struck by is, as I read you, it's very clear that there's some influence of the Jesuit education. My nephews, Matthew and Anthony, Holy Cross, Boston College, they came out of the Jesuit experience actually deeper in their faith. Some people don't, you know that. Kyle MacArthur, young actor on Broadway who went to Regis High School, said recently, I love the Jesuits in that they didn't tell me what to believe, but they helped me to learn how to believe. what was your experience of the Jesuits, and specifically, how has it impacted on all the rest of your life in writing?
The Jesuits were the most profound influence on my life. I feel it every day. Now, we didn't have any money in our family. We were a big family. We weren't poor, but we weren't rich. I couldn't afford to go to this Jesuit school, which is Gonzaga Prep in Spokane, not Gonzaga University, now ranked number one in the NCAA basketball, but the prep school, all-boy Catholic school. I was taught by these brilliant men. I mean, they had PhDs. They were just absolutely brilliant. And I'm talking about punching above your weight, you know. I mean, these guys just instilled with this extraordinary knowledge, but they also taught us to question. They would say, don't believe in God because I'm telling you to believe in God. Come to it on your own. Come to it intellectually if you have to. I mean, there's one priest, a physics teacher, who got on the chalkboard and did this exhaustive formula that proved by mathematics the existence of God. Right. So one of the things I remember that I carry through with my life, even when I was very, very lapsed as a Catholic, was the Jesuit thing I learned from the Jesuits, which was be in constant search for yourself and your God. And if you stop doing that, you stop growing and living as a human. So they were just a profound and wonderful influence on me. I mean, opened my life to so many things. I don't think I'd be where I am today. I know I wouldn't be without this fabulous Jesuit education. But as it relates to the pilgrimage, I'd let my thinking go soft. I had stopped thinking about the great issues that many of the Jesuits taught me to think about. I just gone flat and fat and slow. And I just put all these things aside. And I thought, my God, I'm really denying my humanity, my intellectualism, the great thing I was endowed from the Jesuits of thinking these things through by not thinking them through fresh. So I went on this pilgrimage to fire it back up again, to kickstart it, to think these issues through again. So I really owe the Jesuits, and I'm lucky enough to have a few friends among Jesuit priests, and they're just wonderful, brilliant guys. Yeah. It was a great, great experience.
In A Pilgrimage to Eternity, one of the other things Timothy Egan gets into is something I want to talk about now, a sensitive area for all of us, but one that needs to be addressed. My college roommate was a guy named Rick Lober, great guy, but he would admit that he had lots of problems. You trace the problems, and he now talks about it nationally, but in high school, his mother, who was a single parent, had pushed them to be close to a priest because she wanted the male influence in her life. Well, that priest took great advantage of them, sexually abused them. Rick is wonderful now. He speaks about recovery from that. But your mom wanted a priest around who also violated the trust. You personally, in the book, get into that. You talk about your mother being unable to ever get past that completely. Have you forgiven or been able to forgive the abuser?
You know, this is the toughest thing to talk about of all these things. Yeah. And let me just break it down into two parts if I can.
Sure.
The first part is the existential crisis of the church. And Pope Francis, whom I love and I think is fantastic, and I think is, you know, that's the reason he's most the revered and admired man in the world right now. No one else on the world stage has this. Right. He's truly authentic. He just radiates goodness. He's tried to address this thing, this existential crisis. You know, how could it... church founded on the Prince of Peace and humility and love of fellow human beings have destroyed so many lives. So there's this first part, let's put it aside. Can the church get over this? Then there's what it means to me personally and all the other people who are touched peripherally by this thing. Mm. In my family, my youngest brother was a victim of this, and he lost his best friend. He threw himself in front of a train after being abused by this monster, this serial abuser who, By his own admission, a priest who was allowed into our parish and several other parishes abused more than 60 boys, okay, and ruined their lives. And just think of the ripple,
ripple
of sorrow that goes out into each of those. My family is only one small example of those. So it broke our family in terms of our faith. My brother lost his faith, and he said, I love the grandeur of Catholicism. I love going into a church, but I cannot step into a church again knowing what they did to him. My mother did not lose her faith. She chose to keep her faith. And I'm somewhere in the middle. So you asked a question, can I forgive? And I'm not going to answer it because it's one of the central questions of the book. Yeah. And all good authors know you don't give away the ending. Yeah. So, you know, and one of the drives of this pilgrim is whether I personally, in my small world, you know, isn't worth a hill of beans, to quote Humphrey Bogart, Casablanca, but in my small world, whether I can forgive this church for what it did to my family. And that's what the Pope has asked us to do. He has asked all the victims for their forgiveness. So part of my pilgrimage is to come to terms with that.
And for our listeners in the Pilgrimage to Eternity, he does give you an answer to my question. So yes, I'm going to encourage people to read it.
But if you give the answer, you wouldn't want to know what happens in the book. So, you know.
Let me ask you about hope, though. You know, you're angry at what went down in the church, but I'm one of those 96% of priests who has never touched the kid. Right. And so for the 4% who have ruined it for all of us, there's a great hopelessness in the priesthood. Like, we're all tarred by this terrible brush. Do you have any advice for us, Tim, on how we can ever recover?
You know, that's interesting. My thinking on that has changed somewhat recently as I've become fairly close friends with a couple of Jesuit priests, one of whom taught me in high school and now is president of Seattle University, Father Steve Sundberg. I quote him in the book. I was trying to use him to get to the Pope because Pope Francis is the first Jesuit Pope. Sundberg is a Jesuit president of Seattle University of Jesuit College. And Steve and I have become quite close. And when I hear the pedophilia stuff, I sort of now see it through his eyes. I see a headline and I'm thinking, what about the priests like Steve who are not, you know, did not commit these horrible abuses? The 96, 97%, most of them did not do it.
Yeah.
They have to carry this burden. He said, for a while, I had to walk around town and people would come up to me and see the collar and do something. Oh, you're an abuser. You're this and that.
Yeah.
And he said it's changed somewhat with Francis. Now, we live in Seattle, a very secular city. But he said, after Francis became Pope, he said people started coming up to him in restaurants and saying, nice going, or, you know, I'm happy for you. I love your Pope. So it's changed somewhat. Mm-hmm. But I do see the world more through the eyes of people like you. And I understand that. It's horrible to be tarred.
Yeah.
You know, I'm trying in my both my journalism and my just humanity to see through those eyes, to see that great, great majority. So there's a priest in this book whom I meet at Great St. Bernard Pass. I think you remember the scene. It's the high elevation point of the Via Francigena, 8,000 vertical feet. He's a wonderful guy. And he talks about this, how for a while he'd go into Rome and, you know, people would snicker at him. Some kids even threw rocks at him. He said, but it's changed a little bit under Francis. But he said, you know, I mean, it's tough because the majority is being scarred by the sins of the few.
Yeah.
And the sins of the few are causing people like you to suffer greatly. And my only advice, because you asked for it, I wouldn't normally give it, is to get out ahead of these things, to be on the side of enlightenment, openness, you know. And that's what I think most of the good, that's what Francis has been trying to do. The Jesuits in the Pacific Northwest have all opened up all their books and all their files and, you know, transparency. Say, we did these horrible things and most of us aren't like that.
Timothy Egan, in his book, A Pilgrimage to Eternity, also gets into the sensitive issue of the role of women in the life of the church. I have two sisters, Tim. One is a person with no problems with the church to speak of. One is a lawyer living in Washington who says to me all the time, do you think I'm compassionate, sensitive, kind, and smarter than you? And I say, probably. And she says, but because of my sexual identity, I can't be a priest. How in the world, when you read St. Paul, that in Christ there is neither male nor female, do you justify that? Well, I say to her happily, I'm a priest. I'm not the Pope. I don't have to justify it. I could, but what can we do to change or make better? You know, let's be honest. You love Pope Francis. I love Pope Francis. There are some limits in what he can accomplish in his probably relatively short pontificate. What would you like to see us do to make women know how essential they are to the life of the church?
You know, that was one of the great, you know, epiphanies for me when I was going on this pilgrimage. So I would do a lot of deep reading to complement what pilgrims call deep walking, which is a time where you can just turn your phone off and spend your entire day thinking about a single issue. I mean, God, if I could go an hour without thinking about Trump, it's just an amazing thing for me, you know, and then an hour without thinking about the Seahawks, or an hour about just thinking about the things, deeper thoughts that I'd let slide. One of the great epiphanies for me was how important women were to the early church. Not just Mary Magdalene, who, you know, was, no matter where she was, where you believe and whether she was Christ's lover or not, you know, the Gnostic Gospels imply that she was the lover of Jesus. Whether you believe that or not, she clearly was a top aide, you know, who helped those early disciples, most of whom were illiterate. She was not. She had money. She could help him out. She was sort of a very close person to Jesus and very instrumental role. But then you also look at the early ministries, and women helped spread the word of Christ. I mean, when this was a struggling spiritual startup, you know, remember, 100 years after the death of Christ, the Roman Empire only counted about 2,000 Christians. This was a real, real struggling religion. And women helped carry the day because it was a gospel love. It was a gospel woman. It was only later on all these hierarchies built up, and they wrote women out of the story. And I think that's one of the great, I don't want to say crimes, mm-hmm. but one of the great injustices that was done to
women. Missed opportunity, to be sure.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They had it several points in the institutional church where they gradually wrote women out of the story. Not only could they not become ministers and become officials, but then they made them sort of lesser characters. The great women were all virgins, you know, and the great women were these saintly, not even sort of human, because they didn't have the full dimensions of humanity. And so, and then the irony carrying it up to this day, which you know, is women continue to carry the church in so many ways. I mean, you look at all the good deeds that are done in the name of Catholicism. I think of this woman down in the Texas-Mexico border who's welcomed so many of these refugees who otherwise would have gone into cages. I forget her name, but leading a Catholic charity down there. So they wrote them out of the story. My prediction, such as it is, is that women will eventually be allowed into the ministry. Now, you mentioned the beloved Pope Francis. He's 85, and he has one working lung. So how much time does he truly have?
Right.
Yeah. The other peripheral part of this is that the great growth in the church right now is in Africa, as you know.
Yes.
There will soon be more Catholics in Africa than all of Europe.
Right.
And so I think the next pope will probably be African as well. That bodes well for the church, because it's sort of like the early church. There it's a faith that's not institutionally bound so much, but is bound up in the gospel. So I regret that women were written. It was an epiphany to me to see how much power they had early on, and how they still hang in there.
Right,
I hope
right.
they can hang in there.
To have the patience of saints. Timothy Egan's our guest. His book is a pilgrimage to eternity. Now, I'm gonna segue into something, picking up on what you said. You were in this holy space where you could think about one thing at a time and even block out thoughts of Donald Trump. Now, for our listeners, Tim not only writes this book, but he also has the column in the New York Times. So here's what I'm going to challenge you to do right now. I have lots of friends in the conservative market, and during Obama's time, I'd say to them, can't you find something, one thing to say good about this man? And finally, one of my most right-wing friends would say, well, he seems to love his wife, you know, or he seems to be a good dad. That was the best he could do.
Yeah.
When you look at the whole picture, is there any redeeming value to a guy like Donald Trump?
Yeah, it's funny you say that. During my run yesterday, I was thinking about this very question while being really angry that he's trying to overturn the voice of the people, which no president has ever tried to do before, you know. I'll just say this, and again, it's a two-part answer, sorry. The Jesuits taught me to have nuance, you know. I can't speak in black and white. One is that he just seems by all accounts to be an awful human being. You know, he's had three wives. He's got 20 plus women have accused him of sexual assault. He lies by way of respiration. You know, he mistreats anyone who's loyal to him. He seems to have no real friends. Even his own, you know, niece is his worst enemy, and says, you know, he's an awful human being by all measurements that he's proven himself. Washington Post has documented 25,000 lies. But I will give him credit for this, since you asked for this. I have to give him credit for how he has brought some of the nations together in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm.
That Saudi Arabia and Israel have, you know, been at each other's throats since the dawn of Israel. And they are no longer at each other's throats. And the same is true of several other Middle Eastern. Now, you can say why all those things happen. Maybe there's craven reasons. Maybe there's reasons for oil and the mutual alliance against Iran, et cetera. But I will give him credit for doing that.
Okay, no, I'll take it. I'll take it. That's something.
That's it. Sorry, you're not going to get any more out of
that's
me.
It. That's it. Okay, we're going to take it and we're going to run with it. Now, let me ask you this, too, related to the hope for the future, which Pilgrimage to Eternity is all about. In my church right now, in a parish with 3,000 families, at my mass, which used to get 800 or 900 people on Sunday, now I'm lucky to get 300, 350 people. But online, last week, one of our masses, 16, 17, 18, 19,000 people were watching. Do you suspect that beyond the vaccine, people are coming back?
Yeah, I'm not sure the vaccine, how much it has to do with it. Now, once we get the vaccine, there'll be this huge rush just for connection.
Yeah.
You know, it'll be restaurants, it'll be bars, it'll be churches, it'll be sporting events, it'll be weddings, it'll be funerals, it'll be all the stuff we're deprived of as human beings right now, social contact.
I want to thank Timothy Egan for being with us and for our listeners around the world to pick up a copy of this Pilgrimage to Eternity that he's written about. Tim, it's you know, I was reading a review by Kathleen Kennedy Townsend. She wanted more from you, you know, and I think you gave plenty. You gave food for thought.
It's funny you said that. I love that review, but I also said to my editor, I didn't leave anything on the court, as they say.
No.
I was going dry.
It was pretty personal.
That's as personal. I'm going back to being impersonal in my next.
It was personal and beautiful, and I appreciate the book so much, and I appreciate you today sharing with us openly, honestly, from your heart. And I hope you sell a gazillion copies, because I think the book is enhancing for so many people's lives. And, you know, for the listeners around the country, anyone who says they don't doubt or don't have periods of deep skepticism is probably someone who should go to confession, because we all do. And Tim addresses that so beautifully in Pilgrimage to Eternity. So thanks for the radical honesty, Tim, and we hope to hear from you soon again.
And thanks for having me. I enjoyed the interview.
Thank you so much. As we end today's program, I want to thank all of you for being with us. If you have any questions or comments about the show, you can send them to me through my website, which is www.closeencountertv.com, all one word. closeencountertv.com. To listen to our Personally Speaking podcast with some of our most recent shows, please go to YouTube and search under Personally Speaking with Monsignor Jim Lisante and subscribe. Personally Speaking is also available as a podcast on Apple Podcasts, iHeart, and Spotify. You can also listen to past episodes by going to www.ollmp.org. Ollmp.org, and you get not only recent shows, but also Monsignor Jim's weekly homilies. I'm privileged to serve as host and executive producer, Personally Speaking. Our producer is Lisa Jandovitz, and thank you all so much for being with us. We'll be with you again next time on Personally Speaking.